Hello and welcome to Let's Read the Books of Enderal. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. I'm in the Ark Bank, and today I'll be reading The Butcher of Ark, Volume 9, The Rise, which I found in Bank Vault 2111. You get the key to that vault from Marilla God's Hand at the end of the Brotherhood of the Cora quest. Chapter 9, The Rise. After I had slit my own throat, there was initially only room in my head for astonishment. I was not in pain, even though I clearly felt the cut in my throat. Instead, I felt a sober certainty. I had killed myself. I closed my eyes and waited. Hot, wet blood flowed down my chest in a macabre stream. The pain exploded after exactly 27 seconds. I tried to scream, but only managed a choked rattle. I collapsed and rolled on my side, knees drawn to my chest, like a freezing child. After 96 seconds, my field of vision had become like the view through a dirty, dark red-colored glass pane, and my body was flagged. The red puddle under me had grown to man size, and I asked myself if the numerous animals my foster father or his suppliers had killed in order to obtain their beautiful furs had felt the same. After 105 seconds, I felt life melt away and a pleasant drowsiness take over. How nice it would be to simply close my eyes and sleep, forever and ever, in peace and tranquility. After 150 seconds, I stopped counting and woke up. The first change I noticed was one that was hard to describe, a vague, disconcerting feeling rather than an obvious observation. Although the room around me appeared superficially the same, I sensed that something was wrong, like a deformed man trying to hide his true face behind a mask. Another change was of a physical nature and much more unmistakable. I noticed it when I instinctively placed my right hand on my chest. My heart was not beating anymore. I palpated my neck in disbelief. The cut was still there, but the flow of blood had stopped. My sight was back to normal, my mind just as clear. I noticed a third change when I looked around. The paintings had come to life. The mist in the washing swirled around. Oil paint lightning flashed on the horizon, fading to a milky gray after the momentary brightness. The man in the image was hovering up and down like a forgotten corpse in the ocean. I could scarcely believe my own eyes. Perhaps the lack of a heartbeat was causing issues with my vision after all. My gaze passed the first stone and the first blaze. The same thing. Every painting was moving. The sun rays from the time of rest blinded me, and thick blood seeped from the neck of the man in the painting, the present, depicting the trial. My eyes jumped from painting to painting. I was still struggling to make sense of what I was seeing, when I heard a sound like cloth being torn, and all the masked faces of the painted figures simultaneously looked in my direction. They stared at me, and even though their masks at least partly covered their eyes, I felt their gaze on me like a dark power. I should have been afraid, but instead, the fires sparked and slowly awoke inside me. "They don't want to harm me," I realized in a flash. "They want to guide me." I watched the figures leave their paintings. Liquid paint trickled from them, forming colorful splatters on the stone floor. For a few seconds they stood motionless in front of their abandoned paintings. Then they marched lockstep toward me. Their steps produced no sound, only the dripping of paint made a surreal noise in the eerily quiet chamber. With every step they took, the sparks of fire inside me intensified, brightened. The painted figures formed a circle around me. As if they had rehearsed to synchronize their movements, they all raised their right hand and moved it to their faces. Slowly and firmly, my eyes shifted over the figures, eager not to miss any detail. The sight of them elicited varying emotions from me. I despised the thin man from the limbus. How weak he was. How pathetic. Hope arose in me when I looked at the man from the first blaze. The man from the Renaissance the painting I had studied first, I adored. He emitted dignity and power such as I had never felt before. Nothing could penetrate the cold steel of his mask. He had crossed the limit. He was perfect. The fire now filled every part of my body, my arms, my legs, my chest, and my loins. "You have chosen the right way," I heard a whisper inside my own head. "Now let yourself go." I sighed like a man who held his lover in his arms after years of separation. Then I nodded to the oil figures. They removed their masks, and I screamed. Here some pages were neatly cut from the original manuscript. Opened my eyes again. I was stark naked, lying on the warm stone floor of the hall, but I was not bleeding anymore. Immediately my hand shot to my throat. The wound was gone, though the blood had left a sticky, slowly drying trail on my neck, my chest, and the floor. Half relieved, half shocked, I opened my mouth and gasped for air. I relaxed and stared at the ceiling. A warm, flaring sensation washed over my body. I had passed a trial. I knew it as much as I knew that I would be haunted until the end of my days by what I had seen beneath the masks of my painted counterparts. A sound of disbelief, meant to be a laugh, left my throat. I had made it. I had seen it. And now I was a brother of the Black Libra. A sense of power rose in me as I thought this. This power was different from what the Arcanists did when they let eventualities become truth, or from how the shamans connected to the ghost world through their singing. The magic of the Libra was different, pristine, immaculate. With effort, I turned my head and looked at the paintings. The masked man from the last painting was gone. I was not surprised. When I rose, I was overcome by a heavy tiredness. Slowly, I got dressed and picked up my dagger from the floor. The blood on its blade was still fresh. I stared at it for a long time before wiping it clean on my trousers and putting it back into its sheath. After that, I left the hall. Oh, how complete I felt that day. My chronicle nears its end, and I do not want to waste time with unnecessary narrations. Time runs faster than the ink on this paper dries, and I am greatly exhausted by the events of the past few days. Reading the previous page fills me with anger. How inappropriate my descriptions are, how fragile my thoughts. I can merely hope that they will suffice. Let me begin the final part with a correction. Contrary to the claims of some people, I am no unprincipled murderer. Everything I have written thus far is truthful, no matter how bizarre it may sound. The Black Libra had chosen me long before I knew about it. It had found me, had given me a taste of my destiny, and had made me one of their own. If there was one area the Libra was infallible, it was this. Everyone they killed was corrupted. They had sinned, were guilty of crimes, they were evil. Name it however you like. At first, I assured myself regarding the target's nature before each killing. Later, the superficial proof I had was sufficient to me. Not once was the Libra wrong, no matter how inconspicuous the target. They were all sinners. So do not bother wondering whether my victims were innocent, for they were not. Rather, ask yourselves, was it right to kill them? Back then, I believed it was. The teachings of the Libra guided me, and it was so simple. We have a choice. We decide whether we invite the demons by committing sins. We decide to become corrupted. We, the chosen of the Libra, punish those who are weak. Not all of them, but enough. Enough so that the innocent ones are protected, so that fear enters the sinners' hearts, so that the world is preserved from ultimate corruption. Today I remember the pride I felt when I faced Kalian and the others with a tired smile. Not many were present, a dozen, maybe less. Nobody applauded or cheered, since it was unnecessary. The men and women who were there knew what I had seen and done. Nevertheless, I was surprised when Kalian told me that it was time to return to Ark. I briefly shook hands with those who had had the fire within, and then I sat in the dark interior of the coach again, confused, exhausted. but full of pride. He did not answer my question on why we had to leave so soon. Even today, many structures of the Libra are a mystery to me, and each time I ponder on them, I realize how little I knew. How should I? Not even 6 months later, I had betrayed the Libra, and it was naive to believe that the survival of the trial was all that constitutes a carrier of the fire. No, there was so much more. Hierarchies, rituals, stories, none of which I would ever get to know. Everything happened quickly once back in Ark. Kalian taught me the art of sword fighting and the importance of regular meditation. It was not before long that I observed its effects. Each morning I felt more awake and more powerful. I smiled about the people surrounding me, their clumsiness and inertia. Everything around me seemed so clear. Only 3 days later, Kalian gave me a sealed document in which I was ordered to kill in the name of the Libra for the first time. I would like to claim that I still remember all of my victims, but I don't. The only memories that never fade are those of the Nectar. The procedure was always the same. After receiving the victim's name, I began to research the target and fleshed out a plan. The Black Libra granted me every resource I needed: gold, weapons, poison, when I requested them in a letter that I handed to the concealed coachman. When I was alone with my victim, I killed them and consumed their memories. Then I covered my tracks. Many people admire my perfidy and my cunning plans, as I was never caught. However, I don't think of myself as particularly intelligent or sly. I seem to have a certain talent for killing, yet I made many mistakes that could have cost me my life. I was protected by the Libra. With each killing I performed successfully, Kalian disappeared more and more from my life. He was a mentor, and with the completion of my apprenticeship, his duty was fulfilled. At first I regretted it and missed his presence, but gradually I started to enjoy the silence and solitude. I had enough gold to fulfill every mundane wish, and was surprised how quickly wine and love for sale lost their taste to me. In the autumn of the year 8088, 4 months after my trial, I mostly spent my evenings alone in the room of an inn or walking through nature or the city. I took my time to observe people. How little attention I received! My inconspicuous, not particularly attractive appearance did not remind anyone of the illusionary conceptions of a hired killer. A tall and athletic man with a hooded, concealed face and a malicious smile. I enjoyed the anonymity and the role I had to play. I considered myself a quiet wanderer and a servant of justice who wiped the corrupted ones from life, like the summer wind withered leaves from the trees. My fate was not easy to bear. Never again would I be able to fulfill mundane dreams. Never again would I be able to truly love someone. Yet I was part of something without which our world had fallen into the abyss, rotten with sinful people. The others were blinded. I saw. I never could have guessed how soon everything would change. The day began like any ordinary day, already a few months into the new year. I woke before sunrise after a dreamless sleep, and I felt pleasantly calm when I got up. I had accommodated myself in a Dancing Nomad, a popular tavern near the city gates of Ark. The stir after my recent murder had already ceased, and nobody had asked me about my path or my origin when I paid for my room for 3 weeks in advance from a well-filled penny pouch. My gaze wandered thoughtfully through the cozy room, halting on the extinguished fireplace. I yawned and rubbed my eyes. When will it happen again? The snow lay thick on the trees, but it was beginning to melt in the sun. Soon there will be spring. The thought made me melancholic. I imagined children running across blooming meadows and the craftsmen of Ark gathering below the green oak trees in the tavern garden. For the first in a long time, I longed for company. I meditated, lit a fire in the cold hearth, and had a sparse meal for breakfast. It was not until I left the room for a walk that I noticed the paper with a red slipknot under the gap of my door. I recognized it instantly. It was from the Black Libra. With a joyful feeling of anticipation that I welcomed after my gloominess, I crouched, took the parchment, and opened it. I read it letter by letter, and repeated it after I had finished. Then I threw it into the fire. When the document turned to ashes, I was filled with an uneasiness I cannot explain to this day. It was different from the dull anxiety from my past life that I had chased away, and that, as I had noticed, always appeared when I questioned my own deeds, but it had the same shade nonetheless. I ignored it, lit a candle, and sat down at the small wooden table by the window to come up with a plan. 3 days later, I left the inn on a newly bought horse. Spring was closing in, but the days were still short, and I planned to return to Ark before darkness, which I did. I handed the reins of my horse to the stable lad of the tavern, tossed him a penny, and made my way inside. Back in my room, I arranged the tools for the upcoming cleansing on the bed, like a cutler at his market stall. My target, a young man, was easy prey, I could feel it, and so I had free choice. I decided to go for the long dagger I had used to help Kalian in the brothel. Then I pondered my plan until a short time before midnight I left the Dancing Nomad. The night was starry and relatively warm for the season. Melting snow fell from the roofs with a heavy, crispy noise. According to the document, I could find my target in a noble house in one of the most expensive streets in town. It's always the rich who believe themselves to be above everything else. I bitterly thought when I approached the gates to the noble's quarter. I showed my papers to the guards, and they let me in with a nod. If only they knew. It did not take long until I arrived at my destination. Like all houses in the noble's quarter, it was impressive. Surrounded by high walls, with a heavy, sturdy gate set in a stone arch. The portcullis was closed, but behind it, the paved path leading to the entrance of the estate was visible. The two towers on the eastern and western side of the abode gave it the appearance of a castle. In my former life, thoughts of the cost of such a luxurious building would have brought me down to my knees, but now I only mustered it coldly. I could not see any guards, but a flickering light in the gatehouse indicated that it was occupied. I counted on that. I circled the estate twice. At the back it was protected by the King's Rock and was flanked by other nobles' houses on both sides. On the west side of the wall, just a few arms' length from where it merged with the rock, I found what I was searching for. Finally. My stomach tingled and the ash began to glow. The place I had chosen for my plan was a nice bench at the shore of the Malphus River, which rippled sublimely through the nocturnal scenery. From there, I had a clear view through the gate to the estate of the sinner. It was cold, but I was not freezing. A gray-haired man and a young woman passed by and smiled at me. I smiled back. Then the path leading to the estate erupted into flames with a loud thunder. A cold shudder went down my spine, while sweat formed on my forehead. The reactions I had counted on came quickly. First, the couple noticed the fire. The young woman uttered a shrill cry and clung to her lover. Shortly thereafter, I heard the sound of boots on cobblestones approaching. The scent of smoke filled the air, and I was unable to fight a silent smile. Then I, too, made a frightened face and ran away, seemingly in panic. But unlike the others, I did not run from the estate or towards it. Contentedly, I noticed that the doors were wide open. Two guards rushed outside. Another guard exited the gatehouse, helplessly looking at his colleagues and the burning trees which illuminated the night like torches in a funeral march. No one noticed that the fire did not spread. I had no intention of causing a large-scale blaze, since I did not want innocent people to get hurt. I was only interested in the man who was going to die tonight. I freed my face from the fake panic expression the moment I entered the darkness of the street which ran along the side of the estate. I slowed down my pace and retrieved an iron hook from my pocket. I stopped at the section of the wall I had chosen for my plan. It was 3 times my height, but it was old and fissured. I checked for gaps and pulled myself up with the aid of my hook. Once on the top of the wall, I lay flat and analyzed the situation. The trees were still burning bright, and the porter had opened the gate. Just as I was looking down, two city guards ran through the open gate, but they stopped and looked around helplessly. The porter shouted something at them which I couldn't understand. Four more people, most likely members of the estate staff, had left the building and joined the two guards. Perfect. I slid down the wall and hid behind a bush. Now was the time. I closed my eyes and listened to the blaze inside me. It was content and felt, just like myself, the nearing nectar. Soon, I murmured. I looked at the hedge which had been planted directly in front of the house. I felt a greedy, affirmative tingling. At the tensing of my muscles, it shot up my body, through my ribs, my neck, and my skull, out of my eyes. I gasped and reeled. For a moment, nothing happened. Then the hedges started to burn. I sighed and smiled as if I was congratulating myself. If the hedges had caught on fire as suddenly as the trees, a trained eye could have noticed the magic behind the events. It still seemed unusual, but not like witchcraft. A young man was the first to notice the apparent spreading of the fire. He reacted with a quite unmanly cry. In the meantime, some of the city guards had arrived. They were pulling a fire cart behind them, one of the startling inventions I had never learned to understand. By constantly turning a crank, it could be used to shoot a straight beam of water from a bronze barrel. Its arrival made me hurry. The inhabitants, who had been indecisive until now, fled along the brightly burning passage toward the gate. I hastened silently to the side of the mansion and pressed myself against the wall. I searched for a delivery door at the back. Every estate had one of these, so sacks of flour, meat and vegetables, for the kitchen, did not have to carry through the front door. While I snuck along the wall, I heard how the water from the fire cart fizzled into the cold night. I need to hurry up, I thought, though without any of the nervousness or panic I had felt in my earlier life. I put my hand on the lock, conjured the fire, and watched it melt away. Then I carefully opened the door and went inside. The storeroom smelled of salted meat, onions, and alcohol, and after a while I found a suitable hiding place between three chests. I smiled, took a deep breath, and extinguished the fire. It was only a matter of patience now. I estimated that it was 3 hours past midnight when I decided to begin. My plan was perfect. Everyone had acted just as I had foreseen. I knew it even though a few noises clued me in on what was happening. As expected, the panic had cooled down when the fire slowly diminished. With amusement, I imagined the faces of the guards when they had realized that the flames in the treetops did not perish, no matter how much water they sprayed at them. They could have tried to extinguish it until the Black Guardian awakens, I thought. Only after my silent command had the flames begun to retreat, slow and reluctant, like a wolf being forced to leave prey it had killed in a clearing, without savoring its meat. After 3 hours, all the voices outside had become quiet. The door had opened and closed several times, and after some angry shouts from a man, definitely my target, there had been silence. Without any doubt, he would be looking for someone to blame tomorrow, I thought bitterly, and he would find someone. I summoned the document before my mind's eye. Matumiel Daljul, 24 winters old, and a murderer. Although the records of the Black Libra claimed that the demons had taken possession of him only a few moons ago, they had caused more damage through him than with others in an entire lifetime. He had sinned 3 times, and every time he'd gotten away unatoned. Young Daljul, whose father had died this year, was considered impulsive and irascible, traits which would have gotten any young man of lower status in trouble soon. Yet his father, a wealthy clothier who, according to rumors, had simply earned his noble title by mercantile success, had used his contacts to protect him from any consequences. It's a shame. Perhaps it hadn't been too late back then. The first murder had been committed late summer. He had strangled a chambermaid in his quarters after abusing her. The murder had been pinned on one of his servants. The second murder had been committed in the same manner, in a brothel. the body of a young whore had been found in the sewers. The third murder had been the result of a tavern brawl. Young Daljul had had an argument with the innkeeper, whom he accused of having insulted his dead father. In the middle of the conflict, Mutumiel had drawn a knife and stabbed the innkeeper in plain sight of the guests. Even though he had been called to testify before the tribunal, the result was obvious. How easy it was to turn the world if a few witnesses' tongues can be oiled with gold. Maybe the tribunal would sentence him sooner or later, after the demons in him had caused dozens more victims. But that's something the Libra is going to prevent. I stood up and moved noiselessly. Nobody noticed me while I sneaked through the kitchen and the atrium, up the stairs, along the hallway decorated with old, fine harnesses, toward the chamber of the man I intended to kill. Because melting the lock here would have resulted in an unpleasant scent, I took a lockpick from my pocket, tricked the mechanism, and entered. Many times I asked myself what would have happened if I'd been more aware of my surroundings. Would I have noticed a detail that I painfully became aware of minutes later, with blood-soaked hands and a heart, tired yet racing after the strange, revealing nectar? Maybe things would have taken a different course. Maybe not. The weak light of a moonless sky shone on the mournful scenery in front of me. A large, misplaced canopy bed with rumpled sheets stood in the front end of the room. Books that had fallen from shelves lay on the floor, and a scimitar, presumably intended as a piece of decoration, had been jammed into an expensive-looking table, like in a tasteless still life. I wrinkled my nose and tried to imagine what the whore who had been killed by the young nobleman had felt. Had she sensed her fate as she entered the room in which every corner the empty bottles of wine and the carelessly tossed clothes screamed negligence? Presumably she did. I imagine how she tried to play down her uneasiness with a girlish giggle. I looked at the bed in which the demoniac slept. He panted clumsily, his legs spread and his hands sprawled out like a squire. There he had taken what he wanted from the girl. Had he already started to strangle her then? Had she still tried to stay calm? When had her exclamations of lust become real, fearful ones? I bit my lower lip and shook my head, trying to get rid of these unpleasant thoughts. I would know what had happened quickly enough, whether Daljul wanted it or not, and I was going to enjoy it. I drew my dagger from its sheath. It slipped out almost noiselessly, like a snake encroaching on its prey. I looked at my victim with a mixture of pity and contempt. Regardless of his 24 years, Mutumiel Daljul had the tender features of a boy. A sparse beard grew on his chin. His cheeks were smooth, his naked chest was covered with red spots, and his shoulders were small and lanky. To a certain extent, he reminded me of my former self, except for the obtrusive smell of sweat and alcohol. "The demons are inside of you," I said subconsciously. I opened my leather bag and removed a black, thick cloth from it. Then I sat down next to him on the edge of the bed. In the shadows, I probably looked like a mother singing her child to sleep. I laughed briefly, to which Daljul reacted with a protesting sigh, but he did not wake up. He rolled to the side, moved his knees to his chest, and crossed his arms like a child. I shook my head. If I had not known about the fragile man's deeds, I would have considered him a pitiable, spoiled noble's son, but he was not one of these. He had given himself to the demons, not just once, but several times, and others had to pay the price for his lack of willpower. Therefore, the Black Libra had sentenced him to death. I took a moment to ponder what the killing was going to feel like. Then I grabbed Daljul's neck with my right hand, pressed his head against the pillow, and pushed a gag in his mouth with my left hand. The man opened his eyes at once. I tensed my muscles, expecting him to try to push me back. Yet nothing happened. I felt his almost scarily regular breath on my nose, as if he had expected to wake up with a gag in his mouth. His gray-blue eyes were wide open, and he stared at me with horror. With horror? Or with resignation to his fate? I had planned to stab him at once in his chest with the dagger I had placed on my lap, quickly, without ado. Yet there was something in his eyes that irritated me, and I was unable to name it. For a moment, we both remained in a strange position. Then, Metumiel Daljul, murderer of three innocent people, started to cry. What was first a shimmer in his reddened eyes soon filled the corners, and the tears beaded down his smooth cheeks. A choked sobbing was audible through the gag. I regarded him with irritation. I was used to demoniacs starting to cry or begging for mercy when they were facing their punishment. But it was fear which I normally saw in my victim's eyes, and their tears were a result of the instinct of self-preservation. His sobbing, his expression, his tears, however, there was something different about them. They seemed sad, devastated. What if he is innocent? It shot through my head. What if the Libra is wrong? Why, no. Even in the tavern at the Farmer's Coast, I had found two people who had been able to tell me about his deeds. To doubt the sentence of the Libra was betrayal. Betrayal of myself, of the Libra, of your destiny. I tightened my grip around his neck, still no reaction beyond silent tears. He resigns. He knows that there is no rescue from his possession, and he surrenders to his fate. Time seemed to stand still. Everything happened with an otherworldly clarity, as if nothing existed except for me and the young man I was about to kill. I thought I could hear the movement of his teary eyes in their sockets. Do it. Fulfill your duty. With a cry, which could have been an expression of anger as well as helplessness, I withdrew my hand from the gag, grabbed my dagger, and rammed it deep into my victim's chest. His eyes widened, glowing with relief, which inspired a wave of rage inside me. Regret. It flashed in my mind full of anger. Regret your weakness. I removed the blade, raised it, and stabbed him again, this time a tiny bit underneath his larynx. I felt resistance and pushed harder. Now Metumiel Daljul uttered a choked whine, but still he did not try to defend himself. Irritated, I extracted my dagger and stared at him. His head had sunk to the side, and the gag had fallen from his mouth. It seemed like he wanted to say something, but only a rattle left his mouth. Why, I uttered, to him as well as to myself, why don't you regret? He did not answer. Life was slipping from his body. I could feel it. His sins, I remembered, with a jolt. If I lose him now, I won't be able to see them. For the last time, I lifted my blade and drove it into his neck. A fountain of blood spurted against me, but while the warm liquid on my skin usually caused triumph, I did not feel anything now. Then the fire seized me, and I plunged into the black. Thank you for listening to Let's Read the Books of Enderal, The Butcher of Ark, Volume 9, The Rise.
They just sit on their asses and hope things settle themselves.